Hello, welcome to module 21 of the course on application of spectroscopic methods in molecular structure determination. Now we have electrospray ionization mass spectrometry and MALDI mass spectrometry to cover in these few modules that we will be dealing with in the next couple of weeks. First, we'll start with the electrospray ionization mass spectrometry. Electrospray ionization mass spectrometry as an ionization source and a quadrupolar mass analyzer is a very powerful combination in mass spectrometry. Many modern spectrometers are equipped with this combination of ionization source and a mass analyzer as a standard tool for mass spectrometry. Now, in the mass spectrometry, generally we have a very high vacuum system, and the ionization source is also under high vacuum of the order of 10 to the power minus 6 or minus 7 torr. But there is an exception in the case of the electrospray ionization mass spectrometry and matrix-assisted laser desorption ionization mass spectrometry, where the ionization actually can take place at atmospheric conditions, and then the ionized sample is taken into a vacuum chamber, into the analyzer, and so on. So we will consider first the electrospray ionization mass spectrometry, the basic principle behind the electrospray ionization mass spectrometry, in combination with the quadrupole analyzer. Typically, the electrospray ionization mass spectrometry with the quadrupole analyzer and the time-of-flight analyzer, what we call as the QTOF ESI, is a standard combination. Whereas in the case of MALDI, MALDI-TOF is the standard combination, where MALDI is the ionization methodology and the time-of-flight analyzer is the mass analyzer as a standard combination. Now, John Fenn and Koichi Tanaka were the discoverers of the electrospray ionization mass spectrometry and MALDI mass spectrometry. John Fenn from Yale University and Koichi Tanaka from Shimadzu Company were the inventors of these modern techniques. They were awarded the Nobel Prize for the reason that these two techniques are very powerful techniques in the spectroscopic technique for the identification of large macromolecular system with the molecular weights of the order of hundreds of thousands, so on. Now, the electrospray ionization mass spectrometry and the MALDI mass spectrometry, these are modern mass spectrometry techniques. These are also known as soft ionization methodologies. Because of the soft ionization technique, the molecular ions do not possess so much of energy like the electron impact ionization mass spectrometry. So the molecular ions do not fragment under this ionization condition. That is extremely important. It is primarily used for the analysis of non-volatile, large, and often polar molecules. Typical examples are proteins, lipids, and other biomolecules like DNA and so on. Large synthetic polymeric materials also can be analyzed using this mass spectrometry technique. One can do, for example, molecular weight analysis as well as in the case of proteins and DNA, one can even do sequence analysis in terms of the primary structure of these biomacromolecular systems. This is a familiar graph you have already seen, dealing with the mass range that is covered by the various ionization technique and the sensitivity related to that particular technique. Let us focus on the electrospray ionization mass spectrometry. Now, the electron impact ionization mass spectrometry and the chemical ionization mass spectrometry typically go up to a mass value of 1200 Daltons or so. Beyond that, it is not possible to use these two techniques, whereas the electrospray ionization go beyond 1000 all the way down to 100,000 or so, with the sensitivity of the order of picomolar range of concentration is what we are talking about here. The nano electrospray ionization is a much more sensitive technique, essentially covering the same molecular weight region up to 100,000 or so, whereas the MALDI covers even much better. It can go up to 1 million, close to 1 million or 500,000 kind of molecular weights can be analyzed using MALDI spectrometer. Also, the sensitivity is fairly high. It is of the order of femtomolar concentration one can analyze these systems. Now, a good resource material to read on electrospray ionization mass spectrometry is given here. There are two reviews written by John Fenn himself, one in Science in 1989. This is an older review article, whereas a modern review article is available in Mass Spectrometry Reviews, which is published in 2005. So I recommend those of you who are interested in learning more about the molecular electrospray ionization mass spectrometry for large biomolecular system, can read these two articles. It will be very useful. Some of the materials are taken from these two articles, which are presented in the subsequent slides. Now, here is a electrospray ionization mass spectrometer housed in the Department of Chemistry at IIT Madras. You can see here, this is just a box that can fit on a tabletop, but it can do wonders in terms of the mass analysis that it can do in terms of the molecular weight and the sensitivity and so on. Now in the electrospray ionization mass spectrometer, there is a injector which sprays the solution or the analyte to be analyzed in the form of very fine droplets, and it does so in a voltage region where the sprayer itself is a one electrode and there is a counter electrode which kept here. And during the course of the fine spray, there is also a nebulizing gas which is passed through the sample. This is better represented in the next slide. You can see here there is a coaxial tubes that are placed. In the central tube, the analyte solution is actually injected, and the surrounding tube, for example, the nebulizing gas, which is typically dry nitrogen gas, is what is passed through. And in the fine spray that is produced here, the droplets are formed. And because of the nebulizing gas, the droplets undergo slow evaporation of the solvent until the system that the solvent molecules are completely evaporated and only the solute molecule in the gas phase is obtained. In doing so, the solute molecules also acquire charges of the order of, let us say, here it is typically represented as 30 positive charge, 40 positive charge, 50 positive charge, and so on. Depending upon the kind of molecule that we are dealing with, how many basic sites are there, that many protonation can take place, and this kind of a large charged molecular systems can be obtained in the electrospray ionization mass spectrometer. This cartoonic representation essentially gives the idea that this is the sprayer head, which is kept at a voltage of about 3000 to 4000 volt or so, and this is a dimension of a spray. It's actually a small droplet is what is being found, consisting of the ions which are already in the form of ionized sample, but in the solvent surrounding this one. As the droplet proceeds towards the other electrode, there is evaporation of the droplet and the droplet becomes smaller and smaller. In the process, the droplets burst into smaller droplets, which are called the daughter droplets, and the ions get evaporated from the surface of the droplet in the process, eventually producing only the ions of interest without the solvent molecules being present in the system. By the time it reaches this dimension of droplet, all the solvent molecules would have evaporated, and the substrate or the analyte is actually in the form of charged species in the gas phase in this. There are two mechanisms which are explaining the ionization process in an electrospray ionization methodology. Essentially, they say the same thing, but in a sort of a slightly different language. The charged residual model is shown here. The charged residue model suggests that the electrospray droplets undergo evaporation and disintegration cycle, and each initial droplet leads to a multitude of smaller droplets, and each final daughter droplet contains an average of one or less molecules of analyte. When the last solvent molecule evaporates from such a droplet, the analyte molecule is left with the charge that was originally present in the droplet. So this is essentially saying that the large droplet goes to smaller and smaller droplet until the analyte alone is produced in the gas phase in the form of a charged particle. In the case of the ion evaporation model, as the radius of the droplet becomes smaller and smaller, the field strength at the surface of the droplet becomes enormous, and that directly pushes the ions out of the droplet. So this is ion evaporation model. It's slightly different from the earlier model. Essentially, the electrospray ionization is simply an interface for transferring ions from a solution phase into a gas phase, if you look at the mechanism by which they undergo this. Sample preparation is important in the case of electrospray ionization mass spectrometry. Typically, polar solvents such as water, methanol, acetonitrile are used. Water and methanol are useful because they can also donate a proton to the analyte molecule, thereby producing an M plus H ion. Protonated species can be produced in this particular solvent. And to dissolve the polar molecules, typically solvents like acetonitrile are very useful. Additives like, for example, formic acid, trifluoroacetic acid, sodium acetate, in other words, sodium ion that is necessary for ionization process, silver ions, etc., can be added. Essentially, the proton sources are added to protonate the analyte substrate to get the protonated form of the ions, or the sodium salts are added essentially to form a M plus sodium ion or M plus potassium ion, as the case may be, in order to bring the analyte into the charged form of some kind. Now, the acid helped to protonate the analyte to form this ion. Sodium and silver are normally coordinated to the Lewis basic site of the analyte, forming this kind of ion M plus Na and M plus silver plus and so on. We'll have a look at the M plus silver ion ionization mass spectrometry A few examples from our own research I will show you at a later stage. One can do the electrospray ionization also either in the positive ion mode or in the negative ion mode. Typically, halogenated solvents are used in the negative ion mode. In both of these methodologies, typical concentrations are of the order of 2 to 10 ppm solution is what is necessary for the analysis. Now, let us have a look at the quadrupole analyzer. A quadrupole is a quadruply charged system, and there are four cylindrical or hyperbolic rods which are kept parallel to each other. Each opposing rod is connected to an electrically as well as radio frequency voltage that is applied between a pair of electrodes. This is better explained using a diagram like this. For example, these four poles that are shown here are the quadrupoles of this type, and the quadrupole has the adjacent quadrupolar rods have the opposite polarity, plus, minus, plus and minus. So essentially the ion that is produced in the ionization chamber is passed into this particular field, and this is both a DC voltage is applied as well as a radio frequency voltage is applied. In other words, the radio frequency voltage will alternatively change the charge, plus to minus, minus to plus, and rapid change will be there, and the ions has to resonate in a particular frequency in order to escape this intact. For example, only the resonant ions will pass through the analyzer to the detector. The non-resonant ions will essentially hit the walls of the quadrupolar analyzer and gets destroyed in the process. So this is a mechanism by which the quadrupole analyzer work. A direct current voltage, in other words a DT voltage, is applied, and it is superimposed on a radio frequency voltage. Ion travels down the quadrupole rod between the rods, and they, in doing so, they take a path which looks like a corkscrew kind of a passage is what it goes through. In other words, a helical path is what it takes when it goes through the quadrupolar analyzer. For example, a positively charged ion will come closer to the negatively charged electrode, but then by the time it close approaches to the negatively charged electrode, it will be charged positive because the alternating radio frequency will alternate the charges along the electrode, so it will get rippled. Then come closer to, let us say for example, another negatively charged electrode. By the time it comes close here, it will be positively charged. In other words, the charge will, potential will change essentially, and in the process it will essentially take a helical pathway. Only certain m by z ratio mass will pass through this analyte for a given applied voltage and the radio frequency voltage. All the other m by z values will get destroyed by hitting the walls of this. So by scanning the voltage, one can take one mass at a time and pass it through the slit here into the detector, and thereby detecting the mass of this ion. This is given in another diagrammatic representation here. For example, this is a quadrupolar analyzer. For example, in this particular case, there are three ions, m by z of 10, m by z of 1000 and m by z of 100. The applied voltage is such that only the m by z value of 100 passes through the, this is called the resonant ion, which passes through the quadrupolar analyzer to the detector. On the other hand, the smaller ion, which is the m by z value of 10, has a non-resonant nature, and it hits the walls of the quadrupole analyzer at a very early stage itself, whereas m by z 1000 travels through certain distance and finally hits the walls of the quadrupole analyzer before it comes out of the quadrupole analyzer. So only a particular m by z value for a given voltage will pass through the quadrupole analyzer, and that is the basic principle of the quadrupole analyzer in this case. Now, this is a mass spectrum of certain non-volatile molecules. These are actually ammonium and phosphonium ions. This is tetrabutyl ammonium bromide or ammonium iodide. Please remember that when you do a positive ion mass spectrometry, only the positive ions will be detected. The counter ion, as it may be chloride or bromide, is not going to be detected in the mass spectrum. So this is a positive ion mass spectrum is of the various ions it's shown. These are all non-volatile ionic substances. Normally it would be difficult to ionize them or get them into the gaseous phase. In the case of electron impact ionization mass spectrometry, it is not easy to do a electron impact ionization mass spectrometry of such non-volatile material. However, in the case of electrospray ionization, since these are dissolved in polar solvents like water, methanol or acetonitrile, and sprayed into the ionization chamber. They are already ionized because they possess a positive charge by themselves. So all we have to do is bring them into the gas phase and get them into the analyzer to be analyzed and so on. And this is precisely what the electrospray ionization quadrupole mass spectrometer does in analyzing this kind of non-volatile material. You can see here, this is tetrabutyl ammonium ion. This is a trimethyl decyl ammonium ion. This is a trimethyl dodecyl ammonium ion. This is tetrabutyl ammonium ion. This is tetrabutyl phosphonium ion, for example. So essentially, these are all ionic substances which are easily analyzed by the electrospray ionization mass spectrometry. Now, vitamin B12 complex is a fairly complex mixture of various vitamins containing system, and this is analyzed by dissolving it in a 1:1 mixture of methanol and water and taking that solution into the electrospray ionization mass spectrometer. What you essentially see is choline, which has a molecular weight of 104, niacinamide, which has a molecular weight of 123, vitamin B6, which has a molecular weight of 170, and vitamin B1, which has a molecular weight of 265. These are also highly polar substances. It is not easy to bring them into the gas phase because they are non-volatile material, and hence the electrospray ionization mass spectrometry is extremely useful in this case. Although these are not very high molecular weight compounds, the power of electrospray ionization mass spectrometry is that it can bring non-volatile material into the gas phase, even if they are low molecular weight. For example, this is basically an ammonium salt, and it is non-volatile in nature. For example, it is a high melting solid, and as a result of that, it is not possible to bring it into a gas phase in an impact ionization mass spectrometer. However, in an electrospray ionization mass spectrometer, because it is going through a solution phase and then the ions are getting evaporated and so on, it is easy to detect them in the mass spectrometry condition. This is cyclosporine. This is a large cyclic peptide. This is an immunosuppressant drug that is used in surgery and so on, and in organ transplant kind of a surgery this is used. The molecular weight of this macrocyclic system is 1202, and this is essentially analyzed by the electrospray ionization mass spectrometer. You can see here the molecular weight plus the proton. In other words, the protonated species is what is done. The concentration is something like 0.1 microgram per microliter is what is used here, and it is about 85% of acetonitrile water mixture. It is a highly polar solvent. Water itself can donate a proton and protonate the species. So what you see is essentially a M by Z of 1203, which corresponds to molecular ion plus a proton or a hydrogen, for example. And there is a small extent of fragmentation process one can see in this particular case. This is about 1202 or so. This is need not be a fragment ion. This could be M by Z, where Z is equal to 2, for example. A doubly protonated ion could be seen, for example. And this could be a doubly protonated ion. And this could be a triply protonated ion and so on, depending upon how many protons are added to the substrate to give the specific ion. However, the most intense peak is the protonated species in this particular case. So what we have seen in this module is essentially the basic principle behind the electrospray ionization mass spectrometry and the quadrupole analyzer, how it functions, and some examples of how non-volatile material can be analyzed using electrospray ionization mass spectrometry. In the subsequent modules, I will give you a lot of examples of large biomolecular systems which are analyzed by the electrospray ionization mass spectrometry. Thank you very much for your attention.